Hey folks, Coach Patrick here from Endurance Station, back with another weekly episode. In this episode, I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about holiday damage control. I got the background, those of you watching here on the video know, got my little winterscape background on there, super excited, even representing with my Alpine Grand Fondo, Jeremiah Bishop's Alpine Grand Fondo t-shirt here, just dug it out of the laundry. Nothing says winter like thinking about the Alpine Grand Fondo. No, seriously, what I want to talk to you today a little bit about is what it means to deal with holidays, right? How do we do holiday damage control? And this is one of the more important aspects of our winter, because a huge part of what we're trying to do as endurance athletes is maintain some type of consistency across the winter. It complements the work that we do in season. It sets the foundation for us to really be successful. When we think about being successful across a whole block of time, what we're trying to do is eliminate all of the downturns we have that come with a normal year. And some of those downturns are planned. We just have, you know, professional commitments, family commitments, perhaps seasonality-wise, there's other things that you do at different times of year where you have more time to train or less time to train. And that's natural. That's a sort of natural rhythm you have to your year. Beyond that, then we have the incidental things that happen, which are out of our control. Accidents that happen, sudden changes. We had a pandemic, right? That really shut things down there for a while. Hope all of you are safe and healthy as you're listening or watching this episode. And so between those two points, we have something like the holidays. And the holidays, because they don't fit into either side of that barbell-like example, become really challenging for us to deal with because they don't fit either end. We have solutions for either end. I've got solutions for those disasters, right? I understand, hey, out of my control, I just got to focus on what I can make a positive out of this. And the other side, which is like, hey, this is my schedule. This is my rhythm. This is how things work. When something encroaches upon that, I got a plan to deal with it. I got backups and so on. It's easy. The holidays fall smack dab in the middle, which is tough. Plus, they come with another level of expectations from all of us as, you know, family members, as, you know, good citizens, as coworkers, that normally we don't have to follow or face or have to deal with, right? So usually you can kind of get out of some of those social functions if it's, you know, just like a random, like, hey, Memorial Day, you know, get together for a picnic. You can be like, no, sorry, I don't do those things. It's a lot harder, like end of the year, resolutions, wrapping up the fiscal year, or family-wise, like everyone's celebrating with a big year-end holiday, whatever that might mean for you and your loved ones. Can't really sort of sneak out of that. Like, people are going to know you're not there, right? You know, especially if you come like busting in through the door, stopping your Garmin, gasping out of breath and being like, oh, we are doing that picture now? Like, here I am, like, get me in all my spandex covered glory. And so the truth is, managing these holidays is actually really important. Important for you just to keep what you've been doing all year on track, keep that momentum going. But important also beyond you, to the people who support you, whether that's financially or emotionally or just in general, to do the things that you do. And the family, the holidays are really time where we want to also honor those people and, you know, not just pay respects to that, but also be a part of it, right? Like it takes like a village to raise, you know, an athlete. And I would say for sure, this is village time. Holiday time is village time. So how do we strike that balance? So I'm calling it holiday damage control probably because it'll get a lot more clicks on the internet. But what I'm really thinking about is saying, how do you as an athlete mitigate the cost of being a successful holiday participant, still stay on track with your training, still not lose that momentum, not come back and say, coach, you know, dial me up, put the Coach Patrick signal up in the sky and say, what do I do? I missed 6 days. It was crazy. All right. So we'll talk a little bit about this holiday damage control. You ready? I'm so ready. So are those mountains behind me. Definitely gonna get my cross country skis out and get on those bad boys. So let's talk about what some of the problems are with the holidays. So it starts just even leading into it, right? Which is all the expectations that are around the holidays. So there's logistics, there's planning, there's preparations, whether it's for travel, whether it's for food, whether it's for gifts, whatever all of those things may be. All of that stuff starts to eat into your normal progression of life, right? Like the way that things work for you. You've got dedicated time to do X, Y, and Z, and you do X, Y, and Z. And one of those X, Ys, and Zs is your workout. And that time is kind of the first to go when you got to prepare for something. Can't really show up to the airport and not be packed, right? Can't really take off on that road trip without any gas in the car or having taken care of the oil or, you know, put some air in the tires, right? Whatever that may be. So these things are important. So early on, number one problem is that early preparation. Number two is the actual travel itself. Holiday travel is the worst. Hopefully you get to stay home, although that does come with some cost of its own, although you may not go there this episode. However, holiday travel, just in general, tough, right? So you've got the stress of being out there. You've got the stress of getting places. Everyone's trying to travel. Layer on top of that, or as I mentioned earlier, the pandemic and just trying to remain socially distanced and safe and feeling good about that. And also, whether or not you feel safe, just sort of respecting those who do not, or perhaps those who are medically compromised. How do you find a space where you can just kind of travel and just, you know, just focus on the travel part and not focus on all the other parts? It's going to be really hard to do this year. Right? Just think about rental cars. When we went to the Alpine Grand Fondo, Jeremiah Bishop's epic Alpine Loop Grand Fondo, finding a rental car was crazy hard and crazy expensive. And so when you think about the logistics piece, you have to understand that's also going to come into play here. All right, that's problem number two. Problem number three, I won't go much longer, I promise, folks, because the holidays are fun, right? Problem number three is actually finding time to do the workout when you're there. In many cases, you haven't seen your aunt, or you haven't seen, you know, some distant relative, or you haven't done this thing, whatever your holiday jam might be at work or at home, haven't done in like a year, right? So it's hard, like there's a lot of stuff that's happening. It's not just a block of time. You may not be home. You may not have your pain cave just easily accessible. You can just jump into, like, what do you mean your in-laws haven't bought you a Peloton spin bike to work out on when you travel to see them for like 3 days a year? Like, how like inconsiderate of them. Like, really, I think you should not buy them the next holiday gift or birthday present. Just take it off the list, right? Put that money towards your Peloton bike fund. Now, all seriousness though, that does become challenging as well. So we have to overcome all of these things. The leading in challenges that kind of sneak up, start giving you some signs that the holidays are coming. And then also just the on the ground struggle that you face with those daily sessions. All right. Okay. So big picture wise is what I want you to focus on, which is to say that you've got a progression. You've got to build to your year. You want to be fit at the time you get to race. And all the work that we're doing now in the fall and the winter is helping us get to that point. Is really what you're going to do, like that fourth Thursday of November, is it really going to make a difference to you come next August? I don't know. I'm going to say no. After like 20 years of doing this, I'm going to say probably not. But in the moment, missing that session is going to feel like it is the end of the world. And that's totally normal. So you have to understand, we want to keep the big picture in perspective. And the big picture is you're here for family, you're here to be social, you're going to do something you don't normally do, and that's okay. So you may just have to compromise or perhaps even skip. I had using those four letter words, my friends, but you may have to skip a workout just to kind of keep the machine working and everybody happy. And that's going to be a really tough call for you. Some of you are better at it than I am. And some of us still need to work on it, but it is something for you to consider. Thinking about the value of this one session versus the overall big picture might be worthwhile just giving a hard pass on this one, right? Another option that we can focus on too is just finding that key workout window. And so what this is just saying, all right, sit down, take a look at it. I do this all the time. When I'm traveling with the family or when I'm visiting people with the family, I know that I'm pretty much the first person to get up every morning. Nobody gets up as early as me, thank goodness. And that gives me a few hours in the morning when I have an opportunity to do whatever I want. Could be work, could be training, could be work and training. Could just be nothing, just some peace and quiet. I just like sit there and meditate. Who knows what it is? Really kind of depends on the day before, but that's maybe another story for another time. So when we think about what it means to be successful in these windows when we are traveling and we do have holiday commitments, identifying that block of time that is exclusively yours, where you do not have commitments, is really important. So for me, that's early. So I make sure I go to bed early, make sure that I'm not sort of abusing the sugars or alcohol late so that I can get up in the morning and do my session. And it doesn't have to be the epic session. It doesn't have to be the perfect session exactly the way that I would do it at home, but it's something and it keeps my momentum going. You'll hear the phrase a lot here in the fall and the winter inside organization. Keeps my momentum going, keeps my streak alive of training, getting something done, keeping my Garmin happy, whatever excuse you need, you want to get it done. And so that I can get that work done and still feel good. Even if I just get a 2 mile run in, I can head into the rest of the day feeling good about myself as an athlete, be like, you know what? I'm okay. I did my session. I did my workout, right? That's good enough for me. So it doesn't have to be the perfect session, but it does keep me on that roll, which is really important. And equally as important, hasn't really disrupted anyone else's schedule. No more like just wait a couple more minutes or, you know, you can do that. Like we can take the kids to go do that picture at the mall, but we, you know, just wait until 2 because I'm outside right now and I'm going to do this thing. We take all of that off the table and making sure that I'm disciplined enough to get up in the morning and do that session. So find those key workout windows for you. In some cases, like on some holiday days, like, you know, for some families, Thanksgiving, November time becomes like watch football time. That's awesome. I don't like football. right? American or otherwise. So, hey, go ahead. I get to use that time while you're watching your football game, eating your chips to go do my workout, which is perfect. I get to sleep in and then do my workout and you don't miss me because, hey, TV and commercials, right? So find that optimal workout window, put yourself inside of it, keep everybody happy, do the right thing. Last piece I want to talk to you about holiday damage control, because I would be remiss. I would really be failing you if I didn't mention it, was nutrition. Holiday nutrition is tough because all the bad stuff comes out. And you know what? Some of it is actually pretty darn yummy, right? So that's okay. I usually recommend that you time the yummy consumption close to a workout, right? So, you know, if I've got like, if I know we're having a big Thanksgiving dinner, I'll make sure that I go do a run workout if I can. Once the turkey's in the oven, everything's good, get my run workout done close to when I'm eating. So I know that I'm burning some of those calories and life is good. Definitely not going to be able to run after I eat all that food. That's for sure. It'll be a disaster. And I've tried it. Don't do it. Not a good idea. Not at all. Period. Right? No, thank you. So when we think about what that means from a preemptive nutrition standpoint, here's a couple of things you can take into heart that may work for you. Number one, make sure that you eat a healthy start to your day. If you know you're going to have bad food later, get some good food in early. So really focus on a healthy breakfast. There's no social pressures around breakfast because everyone's focused on the next thing. So have a good, healthy breakfast. Start off your day right. Get yourself in a place where you can say, even though I may have this piece of pie or I may eat these, I don't know, bread rolls or four of the bread rolls with gravy and butter because that all goes together inside my face. If that's your place where you're at, don't worry about it. Instead, start off your day in a healthy way. So you can say, yep, still going. I'm on track. I did my thing. Now I'm going to do this thing and I'll be okay because I did some good jobs this morning, right? That's number one. The second piece is to make sure that you're staying hydrated. One of the hallmarks of the winter problem is simply drinking coffee, tea, alcohol, eggnog. I have no idea what else there is. All this food, salty food, we get super, super dehydrated. And often we confuse the call from your body for hydration with hunger as well. So making sure that you're staying hydrated. I'm not saying don't eat. I want you to eat, but I also want you to stay hydrated. So if you are drinking, balance it out. One glass of whatever you're drinking with 1 8-ounce glass of water, money. Awesome. Keep yourself hydrated. Stay in that equilibrium space. If it is around the nutrition side, then also make sure that you're not, say, drinking a lot of alcohol while you're eating. If we could be like, I'm going to have my dinner, I'm going to have it with my water, whatever it is that I'm having, my solid beverage, and then I'm going to have that, you know, extra bonus beverage, maybe as an aperitif or something a little bit later in the day, not connecting the two with that sugar spike from the alcohol and then the sugar spike and then eventual crash from all the carbohydrates as well. Maybe we can kind of space it out a little bit on your body. Take it easy, right? You're not ready for this, despite what you may think, right? Even though you're a high-end athlete. And then finally, the other side of it, the detox, which is important to keep in mind. I mentioned earlier that post-Thanksgiving dinner run, not so great. There will be some downstream consequences if you do nutritionally go off the rails, if only because your body's not used to the type of food that you're eating. It's fine, but do yourself a favor and try and get back on track again with a healthy finish to the day or healthy start to the next day. So if you can bookend that unhealthy period with some good healthy food choices, makes a big difference. One of the easiest ways that I do that, I have some meal replacement shakes that are kind of my go-to food in my library, and I'll bring everything, even the blender, I'll bring it with me when I travel. So I get a good breakfast and I know I can always get a good snack or shake in later in the day, get my protein, get my hydration and feel good about all the vitamins. Kind of for me, at least mentally mitigates the cost of some of those other nutritional choices that I'll make on the holidays. So to recap, we talked about some of the problems. I'm just about three of them here about the holidays and what they mean leading in and when you're there as well. We talked big picture, keeping it in mind that we're really here for the holidays and for the family, for our coworkers, for our friends, and to be social. We can still stay active, but don't want to lose sight of that big picture. We talked about the key workout windows. That's where you can really dive in and figure out like, hey, when's the best time for me to work out? Minimal disruption, but keeps you rolling. You should get maybe one time over that travel block to really go after it, or at least one time every 3 days. Use it wisely to make sure you get that training session and still stay on track with all everything else going on in your life. And then finally, preemptive nutrition. How do we stay on track making good quality food choices to sort of push off the cost and maybe even stop us from eating the extra piece of pie because we had a healthy shake not too long ago? And it keeps us in the good green zone from a calorie balance perspective and helps us stay better on track with our overall progress, our feeling of progress, momentum as we head into the rest of the year. Thanks so much for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed this week's episode. I'll be back with another episode next week. Until then, be safe, folks. Travel safe. Make good choices. Don't forget your blender. I'll see you on the other side.